you doing? Doing the best you can. Hello and welcome, all you citizens of the world, all you brothers and sisters, friends, family, neighbors. I'm Michael James. I'm your host for yet another edition of the Live from the Heartland show, brought to you on WLUW 88.7 or WLUW.org, as well as other places. And I'm here along with Emilio Davis, who's in the background being our engineer. We're here for you. And it is still the time of the pandemic. So we are not in the studio, but we are doing Zoom from home. And this is number 113 during the time of the pandemic that we have brought you live from the heartland. Let's start off with a good thing in the news. The Justice Department is bringing charges against four Louisville police officers over the killing of Breonna Taylor. This has been a long time coming. People are waiting. The local courts, the state courts, kind of whitewashed the situation, but it looks like there will be a little bit of justice. Some bad news. I'm not sure if it's bad or good, but there's a lot of talk about Nancy Pelosi from the House of Representatives going off to Taiwan. The Chinese have gone, I was going to say berserk. I will say berserk over this. I do have a good friend, Michael Klonsky. He's been on the show. Many of you know him. And he has a blog he puts out, and he also is back on the air over at our sister station, Lumpin' Radio. And Michael basically says, Nancy Pelosi on her Cold War tour in Asia. Today, the world faces a choice between democracy and autocracy. America's determination to preserve democracy here in Taiwan and around the world remains ironclad. That's a quote. By democracy, of course, Pelosi means alignment with U.S. economic and political interests. She has no problems blocking with autocratic regimes when it suits those interests, i.e. with Saudi Arabia in the genocidal war in Yemen. And he goes on to analyze this and discuss this. It's Michael Klonsky's edu-paul blog. You can listen to him on Lumpin' Radio. I think it's on Friday afternoons now. He's back on the air. And he definitely is critical of Nancy Pelosi. I'm not so sure. Kind of like that she did stand up to the Chinese after they told her not to come. So I can be corrected on this, and I'm sure that we'll hear a lot more about it. Another thing I want to bring up on the bad front is that we now, in addition to still having a pretty terrible situation with the virus, with the plague, as I called it last week, we also now have monkeypox, and the Biden administration has declared monkeypox a national health emergency. There's a little bit of flack for lack of testing and vaccine shortcomings, similar to what happened with COVID. We'll see what happens and what comes to be on that front. But again, things are not over on the health front in any form or fashion. We need to all be diligent and pay attention and be considerate of our friends and neighbors. I'm living in a house where someone came down with COVID, and he's been isolated, and we've worn masks and kept our distance. So far, so good. Keep you posted. In memoriam, two people to mention. This is the first week in a number of weeks where I haven't been someone I know and a friend having passed. But Bill Russell, a giant in the basketball and in the humanitarian world, passed away this past week. He was an Olympian. He was an NBA player and champion. He was a first Black coach in the NBA, I think probably in any major sport. And he passed away, as did Vince Scully, the longtime announcer for the once upon a time Brooklyn Dodgers, then Los Angeles Dodgers. And I was a Dodger fan growing up. I loved Red Barber, and Red Barber's assistant announcer was Vince Scully. There's been a lot of accolades on TV about him, a lot of attention paid to him. He was quite a guy, and he was really good with the words. Rest in peace, brothers, both Bill Russell and Vince Scully. On the environmental front, the word is that the Inflation Reduction Act, which seems to have gotten a boost when Senator Sinema from Arizona is going to go along with it with some, I don't know, minor or major changes, but the word in the news on Friday morning when we're recording this for the week of August 6th on Saturday on, is that she is now on board. And the word is also that this bill could slash emissions by 40% if it gets passed. It could put the U.S. within striking distance of President Biden's goal of having emissions by 2030, halving, H-A-L-V-I-N-G, emissions by 2013. I also did see a piece in the New York Times that said the bicycle activists are a little bent out of shape because the climate bill, while it's great, leaves out bicycles, which is a major form of transportation in many parts of the world and probably is on the upswing here in the States and probably should have been included in the bill. On the voting front, we're going to do a lot of talking with our guest later on in the day, David Orr, the former Cook County clerk, who is kind of the guru around voting and voting rights. But let me just say that Kansas and the vote to protect abortion rights there was monumental. And it goes to show you that when people are motivated, they will come out to vote. On the labor front, there's a lot of activity. We are going to have a major labor report from our good friend Bob Lawson next week. So be ready for that. He's been an organizer not only with the United Auto Workers, United Farm Workers, with AFSCME. I first knew him when we both worked in Joint Community Union and Rising Up Angry. He's quite a guy. He has his finger on the pulse of what's going on in labor, and that will be next week. On the gun front, there's a guy named Alex Jones, who I never paid much attention to. He's a right-wing commentator. He's been in court. He was grilled about his claims that the Sandy Hook massacres in Newtown, Connecticut a few years back were made up and were false. He had to actually concede that that was not true. And inadvertently, his lawyers turned over all kind of phone messages to the prosecution. So Alex Jones seems to be getting his due. Let's hope so. On the sports front, I'm really sad to say that Brittany Grenier, the outstanding basketball player from the United States who is imprisoned in Russia, was sentenced to 9 years in a Russian prison on drug charges. It's close to the maximum due, the maximum possible. It's going to add pressure to the Biden administration to try to make a deal with Moscow in a prisoner exchange, which is clearly unbalanced. But at this point, let's just bring some people home. There's already bad guys over there. One more isn't going to make that big a difference. Let's take a little tour around the globe and not so much a tour. Let's just go to South America and we're going to go to Colombia. And I have a report that came from OZY.com. They have a daily newsletter called The Daily Dose with fresh stories and bold ideas. And on Colombia, they report a growing number of demobilized communist rebels have recently turned to a more civilian pursuit, brewing craft beer. Now they hope Colombia's first leftist president, who is going to be inaugurated, I believe, this Sunday, can create the conditions for a divided country to come together over a pint of Pilsner before the faltering peace accords leave everyone with a bitter taste in their mouths, before the faltering peace accords. He's part of a collective of ex-guerrillas that brew Trocha, a beer in one of many breweries started by former guerrillas in recent years. Groups like this are hopeful that the recent victory of Colombia's first leftist president, former guerrilla, will bring an end to the cycle of rising violence in the rural countryside and years of broken promises and conservative governments. We are rooting for the new president of Colombia to be, and it's good to get that report on beer. If you are a beer fan, I know you're going to be looking for that, and hopefully you can find it somewhere. We're going to take a short musical break, and we're going to come back, and I am honored to say we're going to have the 49th Ward alderperson, Maria Haddon, coming on to talk not about all the things that we've been planning to talk about, but to talk about the homelessness situation, the homelessness camp encampments in Rogers Park, and what's being done about it. So we'll be right back with more Live from the Heartland. Stay tuned here on the left end of your dial.
Come gather around, people, wherever you roam, and admit that the waters around you have grown, and accept it that soon you'll be drenched to the bone. If your time to you is worth saving, then you better start swimming or you'll sink like a stone. For the times, they are a-changing. Some writers and critics who prophesize with your pen, and keep your eyes wide, the chance won't come again.
Good morning to you, Alderwoman Haddon. We're really glad that I could get you. I know you have a busy day, a lot on your mind and a lot to deal with as the wonderful alder person of the mighty 49th Ward. We've been talking about getting together with you to talk about a lot of things, but today I just want to focus on one thing. And if you could give us a little report on homelessness in the 49th Ward. Throughout the country, we have a serious homelessness problem. And that's certainly true of Chicago and in the 49th Ward. And you have taken some steps to deal with a couple of homeless encampments that we have. How about sharing a little bit of the what's going on kind of stuff?
Sure. Thanks, Michael. So like you said, we're seeing just the increasing levels of people experiencing economic hardship of all times, right? All kinds, including homelessness. We saw a big rise in this kind of at the beginning of the pandemic in 2020, right, when employment changed, people lost loved ones, all of our worlds were turned upside down. So here in the 49th Ward and around the city of Chicago, we're seeing just increased numbers of people experiencing homelessness, especially people experiencing homelessness for the first time. Right. People who've never had to live unsheltered or on the street, folks who haven't had to double up before and live with friends or relatives. So it's been a really difficult time. The city prior to 2020, has had some funds for homelessness outreach prevention, right, through our Office of Department of Family and Support Services, but not very many funds, and none of them, no dedicated revenue stream for that work, right? Because of the CARES Act and because of the ARP funds that we got from the federal government, the city has really ramped up efforts and funding. So from about $24 million to about $265 million, right, that we're spending on securing apartments for permanent supportive housing, for working with agencies that are doing, mental health outreach, physical health outreach, going out and doing direct outreach with folks who are unsheltered and living outdoors. Here in 49th Ward, our most visible sign of this increase has been the encampment at Toohey Park, right? So starting last summer, we saw, as high as kind of 25 to 30 individuals, who've been living in the park. And using some of those additional funds, we were able to do 3 times weekly outreach, right? Kind of understanding, what individual circumstances are. What happened, why have they lost their housing, and how can we get them in housing? So since last year, we've had 2 of what's called these accelerated moving events that the city does. And it's been phenomenal. Like, this is where we identify apartments, right? And we house people first. And then people, once they're housed, they also have, caseworkers, social workers who are helping them to kind of figure out what other barriers they need to overcome in order to sustain that housing. So we've housed 64 people from our area since last year. And so our last big event was in March. We're planning another one for this fall. And I'll say after the March event, the encampment at Toohey, the population was down to like 2 or 3 people. Right. So a lot of people were happy to receive the services, were really excited to be able to have their own apartment. And again, this is just people experiencing circumstances all across the board. But more and more people are becoming homeless, right? So we've seen the population grow at the park again this summer. So the service and outreach work continues. We're working on the accelerated moving event. Now, another piece of this is the city's overall access to housing and shelter. And so we also have an emergency shelter system that's managed by nonprofits. So here in the 49th Ward, this week we had two community meetings where I announced my decision to support a special use permit for Northside Housing, so an organization with about 40 years of experience running men's shelters. And working with men experiencing homelessness to secure housing and address any issues in their life, right, that have contributed to their homelessness. And they're going to be moving into the vacant health center at 76 46, yeah, North Clark Street, so Clark and Birchwood. So it was a kind of a big process, a lot of engagement that we did with residents around this, because a lot of folks have mixed feelings about having a men's shelter in the community. We do have a shelter for women and families in the community already, run by Good News Partners, that's been here for a long time, and that's a fantastic resource. But one of the tricky things about this proposal is that, while this will help residents in our ward, it's part of the broader system, right, of the city, the shelter system that we rely on when we're trying to house people in emergency circumstances, when we're trying to make sure people get housed because they can't be outdoors because of, super hot or super cold weather. And if they had not been able to get their special use permit approved here and access this place, Northside Housing said that they probably were going to close by the end of this year. They've been without a home for almost a year and have housed 50 of their clients at the Super 8 Motel over on Sheridan Road for close to 12 months now. And it's a very expensive way to house people. So happy that the 49th Ward residents gave overwhelming support to this proposal. And I think it's a real important part of the broader system of housing support services that the city needs to continue to fund and to increase as we're seeing the need increase.
Well, Maria Haddon, thanks for sharing all that with us. I didn't get to go to those meetings, but I did see some reporting Thursday night on CBS, which basically really hyped up that there are people who are still critical. And one person was kind of interesting in saying that just because we're raising these questions doesn't mean that we're, well, basically, it doesn't mean we're right wingers. There has been some debate in the community, and I think it's a pretty much an educational opportunity for all of us who look at the broader perspective of things. And is there anything that people can do? You have come out with your decision to let this shelter for men to go forward. Anything you want to share last minute before you go off to deal with a number of other things that are on your plate today?
I'll just say, for all of our residents, we had a lot of people ask, what they could do to help. A lot of folks who understood, they are seeing more of our neighbors experiencing homelessness. You know what's happening. So I'll give people a few things they can do. One, we have several groups and community organizations that do outreach to neighbors in the community. They're checking in on them. They bring water when it's hot, food, clean clothes, building relationships with folks to figure out, if maybe you have or
Ah,
services.
I got a ferocious thing there.
Yeah, Ben says hi. You've got skills or services that are helpful. Two, I'll say volunteer with organizations that are serving our homeless residents. Good News Partners, once Northside Housing is set up, they'll be able to accept volunteers. Both those organizations are always accepting monetary contributions, right, for the good work that they do to expand those services. And then lastly, I'd say on the legislative front, if you're interested in kind of what the city's doing, right, what some of the systemic solutions are. I've been the lead sponsor on an effort called Bring Chicago Home. So a broad-based community coalition of folks who are working with us to try and create a dedicated source of funding for the city to continue to be able to house people. And so legislatively, look out for my updates there, but we're going to need your support at the city level on that.
Well, Maria Haddon, thanks a lot for joining us. You keep up your great work. We're really proud of you, and we're glad you're our alderperson.
Thank you, Michael.
Okay, we'll see you. Have a great day. I know you got a lot to do.
Thank you.
Hey, we'll Bye-bye. Be right back with more Live from the Heartland. Stay tuned here on the left end of your dial.
Olha que coisa mais linda, mais cheia de graça. Ela, menina que vem e que passa. Doce balanço, caminho do mar. Moça do corpo dourado, do sol de Ipanema. O seu balançado é mais que um poema. É a coisa mais linda que eu já vi passar. Ah, por que estou tão sozinho? Ah, por que tudo é tão triste?
Hey, hey, we're back. We're back with more Live from the Heartland. And now it gives me great pleasure to bring on a friend, a neighbor, one of the historically biggest vote getters in Chicago and Cook County, a mayor for a short period of time who never raised taxes, the one, the only, David Orr. Good morning to you, comrade brother.
Hello there, Michael. Glad to see you're up and around.
Oh, yeah. It's hard to Great sleep to past 6 o'clock in the morning. I got to tell you, no matter how late you go to bed. How about you? You've been up for a while?
Oh, yeah. I'm an early riser.
Did you happen to get in your whirlpool today?
Absolutely.
Oh, you're the man. I got to come over there.
Come on. Yeah, you're 2 blocks away. I think you can make it.
I will. I've been doing a lot of swimming in the pool up at the McGaw YMCA. But we got some serious stuff to talk about. A lot of us who are alert and aware of politics, we've heard for a long time the Democrats were set to lose in the 2022 midterms. Now that seems to not be necessarily the case. We had a wonderful election protecting abortion rights in Kansas that gave people hope. Let's talk about voting and politics and a lot of stuff. You've been involved in an organization since you left your role as the Cook County Clerk, which you had for a number of years. You've been active with Good Government Illinois. Can you tell us a little bit about Good Government Illinois, what it does, and what big plans you might be having?
Okay, I'll try to connect some of those two together, and you just cut in whenever you want. Well, Good Government Illinois is a political action committee, okay? I think our voices are often don't have the influence we'd like them to because of money and dirty politics, et cetera. So we focus on highlighting best practices, what government can do to help people save money, et cetera. We also keep up our banter about free elections and democracy and what we're in big trouble ahead unless we do something. And third, we try and help good candidates and existing candidates, et cetera. So, for me personally, by the way, let's just start with the Kansas stuff. It's really hard if you're progressive minded and you know how the deck is stacked against you nationally with a Senate that's not democratic. It's absurd. And we still live by the slave constitution. It says every state has to have two senators. So I think about 21 states have 42 senators and they have less population than the state of California. Okay, so like 42 to 2. That's why we have so much trouble. It's not democratic. But despite that, you know, as an old-time radical like yourself, I'm not saying I am, but, you know, you look at historically, what do you get? Your options are what? Violence doesn't get you much anywhere, at least in this country. Secondly, you can just give up and get cynical, the hell with everybody, they're all crooks. Or you can act and you can vote. And the nice thing about Kansas is, we've known for a long time, majority of people don't like these right wingers and what they're doing on the abortion issue as well. And despite an election in Kansas with not even many Democrats on the ballot, a primary, low turnout, that was fantastic. And I would call it a defining moment. Now, those of us like you and me are older, we've had a number of defining moments in our lives.
We have.
One of them was when Harold Washington was elected. Same thing. You can't beat the machine. They're too strong no matter what you do, how many protests you have, how many little aldermen you elect here and there. But all of a sudden, because if you study these things, the conditions were ripe. It just didn't seem like it was all possible. And then lo and behold, for a number of reasons, including the good candidate and a fairly ignorant Jane Byrne and a fairly ignorant Rich Daley, Harold won. And that was a defining moment.
It was.
So the bottom line is those things can happen. It's hard to convince all of our friends and allies. And in this case, jumping on to this last election in Illinois, we won with a low turnout. Often our side, if you want to call it that, rarely wins without a big turnout. But in this case, three elections that I'm highlighting, you know, when there's obviously there's a lot of stuff that I don't like, but yeah, I was very excited about three, well, many races, but particularly three of them. One, Fritz Kage was reelected as assessor against an amazing battle versus the old machine hacks trying to oust him. Secondly, a young woman named Samantha Steele won a very important job with the Board of Review. There's only three commissioners. It's very hidden, but it's critical to the disgusting Madigan, Burke, others. We'll talk about in a minute what they created as a way of hurting the taxpayers. And the third was Nas, or a gentleman named Abdel Nasser Rashid, that actually beat Madigan's state rep. The reason this is so important, sometimes, you know, state reps are important, all of them are important, but there's certain offices that make a much bigger difference than people realize. So Nas can get elected, okay, to state rep, but there's still a lot of loser Democrats down there, okay? But in this case, with Fritz, the assessor now, and the chance to really turn the Board of Review, why is this so important? This is something that Machine carefully created, and they've been pumping it for years and years. This is why Mike Madigan did assessment business. This is why Berrios, who was made chairman of the party and assessor by Madigan, made so much money and all this kind of crap. And I could read the Dead Burke's another one, okay? It's because what they do is they find a way to steal money from the public, and the public doesn't get it. And if you doubt some of this, we'll go into it, you know, on future dates and all that, something we're working on at Good Government. Just look today's paper. Another person from the Berrios regime was recently indicted, okay? And they admitted, not just they pled guilty, they admitted they took over $1 million by fixing real estate assessments in the assessor's office. And he said lots of other people were involved because he wanted home repairs and all sorts of stuff. There's also the FBI has been messing around the Board of Review for a long time. What I'm saying is the key to this is it really hurts hundreds of thousands of average taxpayers, homeowners in Illinois, particularly African-American. It creates makes the Democratic Party much worse than it should be. Okay. In many cases, our leaders in this state are still savaging opponents, using a lot of dirty money to beat them. And they're not all bad, but there's too many bad apples. And third, it just fuels all this money, these tax attorneys. Okay. You know, they'll rule in favor of you because it's not always fixes, but it's the whole system's a fix. And then they'll make a lot of money because they take half of what you can say from the Board of Review, and then they'll give it to their favorite politicians, which feeds that old machine. So it's complicated, confusing, but with these people being elected, we have a chance of making a difference. And so one of the things we're doing at Good Government, we're going to be helping create a tax justice coalition and let people start looking at this. And so when they make these decisions, like at the Board of Review historically, no one understands when they give the Orrington Hotel in Evanston a giant tax break unfairly, who pays the difference? Okay. A lot of times people in Cook County are paying $500,000 more per year, each individual, because of the deals are made here. So, I mean, you'll hear a lot more on this, and it's why I've been harping on it for several years, because it can destroy the worst part of the Democratic Party, which is the main instigator against what most of it believe in. Okay, now we've got some good Democrats, but we're not in control of the party. And recently they threw out a good woman, Congressman Robin Kelly, to put in, no offense, but someone from Cicero. Cicero's still a bad town in many ways. The connected mayor ran as Republican, has now turned Democrat. And these guys all work closely with Madigan. You know, a lot of smelly stuff. We got to keep it up and see if we can kick their asses out.
Let me ask you a little bit more about Fritz Cahey and people who are from the old machine, as you call it, trying to subvert that endorsement, even from the Democratic Party.
Oh, yeah. You know, the nice
We had some neighbors in the 48th Ward who don't look too good on this.
Well, the 47th Ward, particularly.
47th, I apologize.
You know, it's so important. I know people get so burned out by some of the politics, but character is still terribly important, okay? And when you see a race like this, the 47th Ward is not like it used to be under the powerful Ed Kelly. It's much more progressive, okay? It's elected better people. In this case, Cahey, despite the opposition from the ward committeeman, a lobbyist, okay, and a woman named Bridget Gaynor, who wants to be president of the board or wants to be mayor, you know, attractive, articulate woman, smarter. Well, why did she savage Fritz Cahey in the 47th Ward? Why did she plan to endorse him and then back out? And we have to ask these questions. Why did she? Well, let's see. There's a powerful, very powerful conservative white union still influenced by Madigan that went against Cahey, along with some very powerful real estate. So I don't have, you know, I just some suggestions. When you go against someone you know is a far better candidate, and you know the woman running against him is not a good candidate, and had a husband that was making everybody angry by his anti-Semitic statements, his anti-immigrant statements, his anti-Latino statements, et cetera. And you go that way, well, let's see. Well, you can get Madigan's backing, you can get powerful conservative unions backing, and you can get powerful downtown commercial real estate. That doesn't sound like a progressive. That doesn't sound like a reformer in any way. So you have to ask, who are these people and why are they making the decisions they do? So it's important that we let people know that and talk about it. You know, politics is complicated, but it's the art of managing conflict. And we need to separate those people who do it for themselves, which is what that crook in the assessor's office and what so many elected officials do. They're in it for themselves. They want the money. Obviously, all of them we talk about, we don't realize they're going in every day. Can we get a contract for my brother? How do we make sure that my friends get this contract? It's still a pretty smelly place. And we can't forget that. We get applaud the things that have happened and some of the good folks, but our work is still ahead of us.
On that note, let's start local to global again, or we're going to talk about, I want to ask you about aldermanic flight in the city and your thoughts on the city council, and then we'll take it to the state and beyond.
Yeah, I think for you who haven't seen, there's another article in the Sun-Times by one of the weaker reporters. But it's basically, it's because all those stories are intended to kind of attack the mayor or reform in general. But in this case, it was talking about Tom Tunney, who said he might not run again, or he might run for mayor. And they were listing all the aldermen. That's where we get the word kind of aldermanic flight. The irony is a lot of the hacks are not fleeing. Now there's people that have been indicted or convicted and they're leaving. There's other people that ran for office. Remember this name, George Cardenas, who did get elected to that three-member board along with Samantha Steele and Larry Rogers, who's always been in Berrios and Madigan's pocket. Very powerful, articulate lawyer, but on the wrong side of history, I think. So a bunch of them are leaving. There's not a lot of good ones leaving, so I'm not too worried about that. Remember, they make a lot more money than I realized. When I first ran for alderman, in 1979, they were making, I think, $1,500 a year. And now they're making.
Now that you said they're now they're making big bucks. You froze up again for a minute, but you're back.
Good. In other words, it's a more complicated story. In some ways, politics in this country has gotten very ugly, very dirty. You know, people just, you know, how can I say it? Now, I'm not asking people, to respect their opponents. I mean, we shouldn't respect these hacks in the Supreme Court. We shouldn't respect some of these aldermen, Ed Burke laying around milking the city after he should be in jail. But there's certainly, you don't have to lie about your opponents. You don't have to lie about conversations you have with others. And it's gotten a really ugly place, even in progressive caucus, that people are just attacking each other all the time. So that makes it uncomfortable for many. And it's a reason why when you've got this big pension, because if you're making $118,000, you're going to retire with a pension of about $100,000, plus a few other goodies. So again, I'm not pretty worried about it, but I think one of the other things that we all need to be talking about, and people are, and one of the things we want to do at Good Government, is what are those issues that we can be talking about as all these candidates for office run for mayor, clerk, city clerk, city treasurer, and mayor. What can we push? What can we get them to try and support? Trying to stop some of the corrupt, dirty money. For example, we passed legislation back when I was in the city council, thanks to Harold, that put a limit on how much elected officials could get from vendors. Remember, there's thousands of vendors, and vendors feeds the political system. Okay, so we put a limit on it. Okay, which was good. It's a step in the right direction. The problem is what they've gotten away with now, partly because of the courts, is that vendor, that business, powerful or small, maybe give you, Alderman Michael James, you know, gives you $1,500, okay, which is limited. I wish it was less. But then all of a sudden, you know, his aunt and his uncle, his daughter, 6-year-old daughter, and his dog are all given money too. So it destroys the value of that particularly important law. So just an example of, we try and use these elections to get people to commit to some of these things that would make a difference, whether it's on housing or police or campaign finance, et cetera.
David, I think each time we've had an election in recent years, we've had more so-called progressives come on board. And I would bet that would continue to be the case. I mean, I don't know who's running for aldermanic positions coming up, but we'll certainly keep our eyes on it.
Okay. Remember, there's progressives. Remember, everybody nowadays kind of runs as a progressive, even when they aren't. Right. And it means different things to different people. But keep in mind, our problem is we have some good people we've elected over the years at all levels. But the real power is in the hands of Chris Welch, Don Harmon. And I could go on and on. And
who are those guys? Who are they?
Well, Chris Welch took Madigan's spot, and I think he is acting like a Madigan. You know, used a lot of the private school money to beat every possible challenger to his state rep. He's got a right to lead. He's got a right to support that. I'm just saying, there's a lot of old politics in some of these people. And what happens then is some people that we really respect, some of our good legislators or good aldermen, they tend to lose some of their progressive zeal as they want to try and move up. And that happens very frequently. Lots of people we know over the years. And so their zeal for reform kind of gets a back seat. So when we talk about just electing, it's not just electing people, it's keeping more accountability on the ones we have elected. Because many of the ones that you all know their names of, I'll tell you, they're cutting deals behind the scenes every day. And those deals are not necessarily helping the public. You know, like I say, some of these.
David Orr, what's your take on the prospective candidates for mayor and our current mayor?
Well, my perspective is we have a real problem, meaning if we put away all sorts of things and we just want the kind of reform or progressivism that I think most of us support, even though there's, you know, layers of this. The problem is, if we're not careful, let's say the old party, what's left of the old machine, okay, the 19th Ward, some really powerful figures, the ones that decide it's Chris Welch, okay, or the ones with the certainly very powerful unions, some of them are less progressive than we'd like. Fortunately, some of them are progressive. If we're not careful, I don't think they've shown their hand yet. Okay. Now keep in mind, they're very good at exploiting things. Okay. Encouraging people to run, to mess things up. All I'm saying is we got to be very careful. You know, there's certainly been a number of mistakes at City Hall. The difficulty is someone like Lightfoot, her heart has always been in the right place. She is an absolute fighter for the little guy, even though many mistakes are made. Okay. Now, some of them maybe not be her fault, others are. So I think we just have to be really careful as we proceed, or we'll end up with a modern day daily. Okay. Somebody that sounds good when they come in, and then, you know, young rich daily bankrupt the city to a great extent. People still like him. They probably respect him, but he did a pretty bad job for the city in a lot of reasons. And the same powerful people that have been getting these contracts and spreading the contracts to study O'Hare Airport for a while, those people want the city not to move forward with equity, the things that we believe in. They really are nervous about that, because it's not so much they're anti, they're racist always. They want their piece of cake and they want to keep it. But to keep it, it's got to keep some people down. It's like the police department, okay? The police department under old man Daley knew it was there to make sure African-Americans didn't cross the line. And that's what we mean by old segregation. Stay in your schools, stay in your dilapidated housing properties, okay? So we need to understand that stuff so we're careful as we move ahead and make these tough decisions about who we should support for alderman or mayor.
David, we're gonna run out of time, but I wanna ask you one last complicated question. How do you think the Democrats will do in the fall election in November? And where do you think democracy stands these days?
Well, democracy is in extraordinarily serious trouble, and they're connected. They're extraordinarily serious trouble because the only way a representative form of government works is that you respect minority rights, but generally give a lot of leeway to majority opinions. And like I said before, we have many structural challenges, not just structural challenges. That's why I mentioned the thing about the Senate. The Senate is an absolute embarrassment, okay? And again, created of a racist constitution that said African-Americans were 3/5 of a vote, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You can't have something where majority of people do support certain abortion rights. They support all sorts of things that the Senate won't let happen, okay? I believe the Senate should be changed. These are very difficult things. So back to this, so we're facing enormous problems from the structures that are already there, that as Republican Party becomes a right-wing, more conspiratorial party, because that's the only way they can go to maintain power, that creates enormous challenges for us, and that's why we see all the voter suppression that's blossoming everywhere. The hope may be, like we mentioned Kansas before, is the voters can overwhelm this, okay? The voters are not right wingers, okay? Many Republicans are disgusted with some of the Trumpism. The real question is, will they vote? So one, will the abortion issue, as one example, make a difference? Will people need to understand when they listen to the media, they gotta be careful what the media is peddling, which is often the case? And third, will more Democrats support the history we believe in? If Democrats continue in some cases try and be corporate Democrats, corporate folks, then what they keep doing is they compromise everything so they don't make the progress they need to. At some point you have to say, no, the rich have to pay their fair share. Corporations shouldn't be allowed to do all these things. You can't just destroy the environment and get away with it. So I'm saying Democrats have to be more progressive, not in crazy ways, but in good ways. And if those things happen and people see that and vote, we have a shot. If not.
Well, I'm gonna have you back on so you can help do the talking. Thanks a lot for coming on, and I'll see you in the neighborhood in the next couple of days, David. Thank you so much.
See you in the hot tub, Michael.
Right on, brother. Okay, everybody, we'll be right back with more Live from the Heartland. We're going to take a look at some memorial stuff going on up in Highland Park, and we'll be right back with more Live from the Heartland here on the left end of your dial, unless you're getting it on youtube.com/heartlandmedia. Hey, my brother, what have you done? we're back. We're back with more Live from the Heartland for the week of August 6th. And I'm really happy to bring on someone who I don't know if we've ever met before. We might have crossed paths. We certainly know some of the same people. Jacqueline von Edelberg. And she has been active doing memorials, not only around the city, but certainly up in Highland Park. You know, it's been just over a week since the 4th of July. Well, it's been a month, not a week, a month since the really tragic and sad, needless killings of a number of people up there. And I know that Lynn Orman, our music producer, is really excited about some of the artwork and the music you've been bringing up to that memorial. How about telling us a little bit about what you've got going on in Highland Park?
Sure. Well, the story actually starts before the shooting. My public art installation called Enough is up at the Highland Park Art Center. It's 30,000 pieces of orange fabric that represent all the kids who've been killed since Sandy Hook. And before it was up in Highland Park, it was in Inglewood at the Wear Orange event for Hadiya Pendleton at iGrow Chicago. And the mayor tied a note onto the fence, as did the first lady, as did, you know, community members there. And before it was in Inglewood, it's been on the lawn of the United States Capitol three times, once with March for Our Lives with David Hogg and Emma Gonzalez, once with the Toms and Gun Violence campaign, and once with a coalition of faith leaders led by St. Sabina's Father Flager. We had an event at the Art Center in front of that installation. We tied all of the names of the Texas victims onto the fence. And that was with Congressman Brad Schneider, Representative Bob Morgan, Moms Demand Action, Students Demand Action. And Dana Gordon, one of the amazing activists up here, finished her remarks by saying, you know, this could just as easily be our own children. And 9 days later, we had the shooting in Highland Park, of which, you know, our own kids marched in that parade in robotics and band. So this is all deeply personal. I brought fabric to the vigils, and people tore all of that fabric and made an installation that stretches an entire city block. And then two amazing guys from California made these images at one of the memorials. And together with the community, we've really kind of empowered, leveraged, added some glitter magic to that particular memorial. And thousands of people have helped. We tied yarn to all of the posts of this pavilion. And people have written thousands of notes. I mean, more than 6,000 notes now are on the pillars of that installation. And it's just been, it's been one of the most intense and cathartic and hopeful and tragic experiences of my life.
Jacqueline, let me ask you, what led you to initially start doing this kind of work? Maybe where do you come from and what led you to become a progressive artist activist who I'm looking to know more about?
So, you know, I've been doing progressive art on progressive issues, public art on progressive issues for decades now. My work is on immigration, women's rights, LGBTQ, and voting. The gun violence piece started after Sandy Hook with the thought that, like, gosh, this has got to stop. And maybe we could take the LGBTQ pride fence that we've done at Nettlehurst, which are these rainbow pieces of fabric that you've seen on the corner of Broadway and Melrose. And what if we flipped those all orange and wrapped enough context around it? Could we in fact create tremendous change? And the answer was yes, obviously, not enough, but some. And then this really solidified as an idea in Atlanta. We went down to Atlanta and helped flip the election in Atlanta. The idea was, could you take this kind of fabric and humble materials, yarn, chalk, fabric, turn them all red, white, and blue and make them nonpartisan and throw them in Atlanta and see what stuck? And we did that. And we had an art installation that culminated in a 250-foot billboard of artists and activists making an installation right through the middle of Atlanta underneath the Hosea Williams mural by Fabian Williams. Working together with our partners, Block Power and Focus 2020, we helped deliver 25,000 votes to help flip the election with using these kind of guerrilla sticky art interactive techniques. So there is power. The goal is obviously to create a space that's healing and hopeful and beautiful and gives respite. But beyond that, the real goal is to turn art into action and turn anguish into action. And if through this incredibly epic and beautiful community expression, we can drive real systemic change, that's what we're aiming to do.
You know, I was watching the news last night, which would have been Thursday. We were recording Friday for the week of August 6th. One of the things that was on one of the news channels I was watching was people in Waukegan talking about wanting the same kind of resources that Highland Park has gotten. So there is a class question about not only where the art is, who produces it, what it's saying. Do you want to address that at all? Because clearly the need for artists in action to make the world a better place is right up there on the top of all the things we need.
Absolutely. And I think that's really the key message that we're hoping with this piece and every other piece, is that this is the literal thread that connects the south side of Chicago to the west side of Chicago to the north side of Chicago. This is not an Olympics for loss. The pain that a mother feels in Highland Park when she loses her child is the same pain a mother feels in Inglewood. Obviously, these are very complex issues. Yeah. The trauma is felt more severely in Black and Brown neighborhoods because it's more ubiquitous, but the pain is the same. And the solution is the same, and the culprit is the same. The culprit is gun violence. It is our collective responsibility as a society, as a community, to address this problem with every tool in our arsenal. It is not just one solution. There's no, I hate to say magic bullet because that sounds really horrible, but there's no magic solution, but we should be using every solution. And an assault ban seems like a pretty damn reasonable one. But the idea about attention and resources being highlighted in one neighborhood, obviously our expression is a little different. Everyone's expression is different. I have done this work at neighborhoods across Chicago and across the country. I've made Hope Trees at Tree of Life, in Inglewood, Little Village, Six Corners, Seattle, like, everywhere, the pain is indeed the same.
Let's go back to Highland Park. The memorial exhibit is up, and I imagine it will stay up. And my understanding is there are people visiting every day, paying their respects, thinking about their hopes in the future. There's also musical entertainment and people coming and playing music. You want to just give us a little picture of what's going on and how long you think that might last?
Yeah, it's really gorgeous. The people are there from 6 a.m. till midnight. We even hear that people are there all night long during the night, sitting in the dark, just absorbing the space. We have live music every night at 6:30. Musicians have come, they volunteered their time and they're playing, and we've just started a cookie time at 4 o'clock with comfort dogs. And really at every hour there are people there are people mourning, grieving, they're yarn bombing everything in sight. At this point now, people are wrapping rocks in yarn. You know what I couldn't have anticipated, like, ever, is how therapeutic and important it would be to have something tactile to do with your hands, right? So from the beginning, people are looking at pictures and flowers and crying, and you'd say to them, do you want to just wrap this post? Do you want to help do that? And people are like, you know what? Yes, yes, I do. And people would be there for 5 minutes, 5 hours, 5 days. It's really mind-boggling, but the idea that there is a thing that you could do to help process your grief and talk to other people in the process has been enormously therapeutic for our community.
Do you think there's a way to take what's happening in Highland Park, which it seems to be an extended version of what you've done in other neighborhoods, and expand it in other neighborhoods so that it's an ongoing thing? It's not just one day, 2 days, but that there is a kind of a semi-permanent location where people are going to pay their respects and share their hopes for the future.
Yeah, I don't even think it needs to be one particular location. Honestly, if everyone just took a piece of orange fabric or orange yarn and tied it on a tree outside their house, I think that would create an enormous statement. If people just in chalk wrote enough with the hashtag enough and uploaded it to social, that would help.
And people are wearing orange because that's the color of like hunters wear to warn other hunters that it's a human being in their sights.
Absolutely. And it's the color of the gun violence movement, also on behalf of Hadiya Pendleton, who is the 16-year-old girl who was shot after leaving her Chicago public school exams. And that was just a week after walking in President Obama's second inauguration. Yeah. And it said that orange was her favorite color. So orange is really the color of the gun violence movement. And to the extent that everybody could take on the responsibility for solving this problem for ourselves would be enormously helpful.
Well, Jacqueline von Edelberg, you are inspirational, and I'm really honored that I got to have you on Live from the Heartland and to share some of these things. You're clearly a person who is doing good in the world. I want to share with people who are listening or viewing, your website is www.jvedelberg.com.
Or you can find us on VoteTree. That might be an easier way for people to
VoteTree.
VoteTree, VoteTree. So VoteTree.org would be a great way to find me. And also, no one needs to wait for an invitation to participate in this movement. Everyone can jump in. Whatever your talents are, whatever your inclination, really there is room for you in this movement. And we're hell-bent on making sure that anguish turns into action. So thank you for your kind words, and thank you for helping us, and I'm humbled to walk alongside you in this movement, Michael.
Jacqueline, so nice to meet you, even if it's not up close, but I'm gonna probably bump into you pretty soon. And thanks again. And I wanna thank all the people who listened in to this week's version of the Live from the Heartland show. You may be watching it on youtube.com/heartlandmedia or on CAN TV. You can get it at YouTube at Spotify and Google Podcasts, and we are broadcast on Saturday, Tuesday, and Friday, 9 a.m. on our host station, WLUW 88.7, WLUW.org. If people are out and about in the neighborhood, and I mean the 49th Ward, I will be out on the front porch as long as the weather lets me on Sunday, talking politics and showing people my books and my photos. Next week, we're going to have a long labor report from activist and organizer, our friend Bob Lawson. I want to thank you for tuning in to Live from the Heartland, where we like to question the actions of the rich and the powerful, and to honor and give voice to servants of the people. Thank you to the people who make the show possible: Emilio Davis, Katie Hogan, Lynn Orman Weiss, Imani Warren, and have a great week. Do good out there in the world, because the world needs all the good that you do, that I do, that we do together. All power to the people. Over and out.